Gospel according to John chapter 8. For our sermonic time together, we want to focus in on verses 10 and 11. When you have it, say amen, not say wait on me. And I'm going to be reading from the English Standard Version of the Bible. Follow along with me in your own translation. We should all arrive at the same message. Gospel according to John chapter 8 and verses 10 and 11. And the Word of God reads, verse number 10, Jesus stood up and said to her, "Woman, where are they? Has no one condemned you?" And she said, "No one, Lord." And Jesus said, "Neither do I condemn you. Go, and from now on, sin no more." Let me read it one more time. Jesus stood up and he said to her, "Woman, where are they? Has no one condemned you?" She said, "No, Lord." And Jesus said, "Neither do I condemn you. And from now on, sin no more." I want you to do something different, a little bit different this morning with me. If you're close to somebody, I just need you to repeat after me. Just touch your neighbor just quickly. Grab your neighbor hand quickly. I just need you to repeat this after me. I truly believe this word is going to bless you. I really believe this word will bless you. Just repeat after me. Thank you, Jesus, for dropping the charges. Let us pray. Father, we thank you so much for being a mighty good God to us. Now, God, we pray that your spirit will move and have its way in this house today. Hide me behind the cross, let not my ways nor my word be seen, but may Jesus Christ be high and lifted. This is my prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Jesus, drop the charges. A story was told of an English prince who went to visit a famous king in Spain. And the prince was taken down into the galleys to see the men who were chained to the oar and doomed to be slaves for life. The king of Spain promised in honor of the prince's visit that he would set free any one of these men that the prince might choose. So the prince went through the prisoners and said, "My poor fellow, I'm sorry to see you in this plight. How came you here?" And the brother responded, "Oh, sir," he answered, "false witnesses gave evidence against me, and I'm suffering wrongfully." And the prince said, "Indeed." And said the prince, he passed on to the next man, "My poor fellow, I'm sorry to see you here. How did this happen?" And he said, "Sir, I certainly did wrong, but not to any great extent. I ought not to be here." And the prince said, "Indeed." Said the prince, and he went on to the other, and he heard the similar stories, and at last he came to one prisoner who said to him, "Sir, I'm often thankful that I am here, for I'm sorry to own that if I have received my due, I should have been executed, and I'm certainly guilty of all that was laid to my charge, and my severe punishment," the brother said, "is just." And the prince replied to him and said, "It is a pity that such a guilty wretch as you are should be changed among these innocent men. And therefore I will set you free."
Right.
Certainly the illustration resembled the account in our text this morning. One was guilty, and that was certain. Others had committed crimes, listen to me, themselves, but refused to admit them, or saw the deeds of others much worse than their own. But I'm so glad in our text grace that Christ provided, pardon for the one who was undeserving. I need you to follow me as we unfold this episode together this morning. The gospel writer John places us at a place in Jesus' ministry where Jesus was teaching in the temple. And Jesus' teaching was different than the scribes and the Pharisees. If you follow him in the gospel, you will discover that people was often amazed at Jesus' preaching. When Jesus stood up to preach, sit down to teach, we cannot negate the fact that people was drawn to Jesus because Jesus was preaching from an honest heart, and he was preaching from an honest heart and a pure spirit. And we will find that the scribes and Pharisees, they often put things on people that they themselves would not do. So John now, he places us in this unique episode in Christ's life. We find Jesus now early in the morning, he's back in the temple teaching. He's teaching a group of people. The Bible says all the people, they came to hear Jesus teach. And I can imagine, man, that Jesus was the teacher of all teachers. He was filled with God's spirit, and he was touching people's lives, and people was being set free. And so people was attracted to Jesus. It was wanting to hear this man, Jesus. And so John now, he places us here in this episode in Jesus' life. He was down in the temple, and Jesus is trying to reach those that needed to be reached. Right? They're coming because they've heard about this man, Jesus, and how he has set people free, and how he has given life to others. And they've heard about him. His fame has spread it throughout this region. And he's back here at the temple. He's trying to teach. He's trying to help somebody. He's trying to set somebody free. And the Bible says that we find these Pharisees and these scribes, they brought a woman who had been caught in adultery. I want you to come with me in the text this morning. And I want you to follow me because I believe that there's a word for this.
All right.
Jesus is teaching. He is trying to set people free. In verse number 1 in John chapter 8, you can read this for yourself. I just want to put out some highlights. He's there in the temple. He is sitting down and he's teaching. And here come these scribes and these Pharisees. And here's what hit me, man. See, Jesus is at work because he is disturbing the scribes and Pharisees. Y'all just stay with me for a moment, right? Because remember now, if you back up in John's gospel, Jesus tells them that you search the scriptures. Right? Jesus is telling them all the scripture was doing was testifying of him. Right? Jesus always sat up in their Kool-Aid. He always stood up to them. He never ran. He never backed down from them. And if then the truth of the matter is the people now is so attached to Jesus that the scribes and the Pharisees started to say, wait a minute, who is this man? And now they bring this woman that is caught in adultery. They bring her. The Bible says they threw her before Jesus. And they're saying, now, Jesus, here you are in the temple. You've got a teaching moment going on. I want to see how you're going to handle this.
Right.
Wait a minute now. Wait a minute. It's back up. Because if we watch Jesus and understand who Jesus is, I have to say this. Jesus was a Jew. Right?
Yeah.
He did the things. He had Jewish custom all around in his book. So watch this now. The expectation is that Jesus should know what the law says.
Right.
He ought to know everything about the Torah. He ought to know everything that Moses had laid out. And here's what hit me in the text. When the scribes and the Pharisees, they were bringing this woman that had been caught in adultery and putting her before Jesus. And this is what hit me. You got people in the church sometimes who just try to expose you just for the sake of it.
Teacher, this woman has been caught in the act.
I got on video. I took pictures of her. I got a witness that she was doing this. Now you got to, you have to see the text, y'all, because Russians, they didn't bring the woman and lay the woman before the elders. They brought the woman, they laid the woman before Jesus. Because as you continue to read the biography, you'll understand their primary reason of bringing the woman really was not because she was called an adulterer, but simply to entrap Jesus. They wanted to offset Jesus, and they wanted Jesus to go down. So I said to myself, hold up. Death. Right? So watch this. When they brought this woman to Jesus, their expectation of Jesus was, she's been caught. Pick up your stone and let's heal her. Let's do it to her because the law said she should be stoned. Wait a minute. You're talking to Jesus, the one
Jesus.
Now I said to myself, well, Jesus, you have to enforce the law. Right? You cannot let this go. There's consequences to the woman's action. Right? That's the sin of the text. And the Bible says, here in verse number 6, this they said to test him, that they might have some charge to bring against him.
Right.
Right? Now, watch this. I told you, it really ain't about the woman. It's about Jesus here. And what Jesus is getting ready to do, he's getting ready to teach us a lesson. He's getting ready to show us how merciful and how gracious he is. Right? Because you got the teachers of the law, they're so stern, and they believe that this is how it's got to be done, and there's no other way around it. But I'm so glad, man, when I was reading this and studying this, I watched how Jesus stood up to them back in John 5 when he was telling them, and I know this is disturbing to some, that Jesus is bigger than the Bible that we told.
Stone her, but Jesus, well versed in everything,
decision. And the Bible says, I like this thing. And Jesus said, all right, you want an answer? Jesus stood up. And he said to them, let him who without sin among you, let him who is without sin among you be the first to throw a stone at her. Jesus, go right ahead. I'm going to give you your answer. If you don't have sin in your life, here's some stones. Stone her. And church, should I suggest something to us today? If you ain't got sin in your life, go ahead. Right. Talk about it. Put them down. But I'm a living witness from the pew.
Deserve to be sown.
Jesus was setting, what Jesus was doing here in our text, Jesus was setting up, letting them know, hold up. You don't have the right to tell another person what to do when you yourself are not doing the right thing. So Jesus said, if they don't condemn you, neither do I. Go and sin no more. And now as I hasten to my seat, I just want to encourage the church today that we are like this woman in the text. We have been caught up, probably not in adultery, but we have been caught up in some kind of sin. We have been doing our own thing, and we have been running our own course, and we know without a shadow of a doubt that Jesus, that we should have been caught, we should have been dead, or we should have been put in jail somewhere. And we know that we're not perfect people. We know that we have our own sin, and we have our own things that we're struggling with. And the truth of the matter is, 9 times out of 10, when somebody points something out about you, they're not lying about you. If they say that you have a nasty attitude, 9 times out of 10, you have a nasty attitude. And then the truth of the matter is, when they bring you out, and when they expose you, and when they start to talk about you, sometimes they're not lying. Come on, say amen. Come on, give me a flat head and close this sermon today. He dropped your charges here. All that you deserve, he cleaned your slate. He said, take it off the books. No, erase. Because they accepted. And yeah, he dropped the charges. He dropped everything that was pending against you. And the question that I have for you today, will you be willing to drop everything for Jesus? Will you be willing to give him everything like he has given you everything? Do about the charges. Whatever was pending against you, like this woman in our text, he didn't condemn her again. He didn't go into her life story. I told you not to go down that road. All Jesus tells us, look at here, I don't condemn you either. But don't go do that. That's mercy. That's grace. That's a second chance. Yes. That's the type of God we serve.
Yes.
He did not condemn the woman, but he showed her love. And he told her, don't go do it anymore. With that type of compassion, knowing that you should have died. Knowing that he should have killed me. But yet still, instead of doing these things to you, he tell you, I don't give you, go and sin no more. Father, I'm glad this morning. That you didn't condemn him. But you dropped my charges. You dropped those things that was pending against me. You didn't allow that which I deserve to come against me, Lord. And I thank you for it. And Lord, I'm praying for each member of the sound of my weak voice that we will accept what you did at Calvary. Knowing God at Calvary, whatever was pending against us, you dropped it. Because you died for us. And your life paid the penalty. And we want to say thank you. We thank you for that. And God, because you died, and because our charges have been dropped, God, we can rejoice.
Yes.
And we can tell the world about a man who have shown love and compassion in spite of ourselves.
Yes.
God, we thank you for your word today. And God, when we leave here, whatever the enemy will try to bring against us, help us to reach back and remember you drop our charges at Calvary.
Yes.
So we don't have to carry those charges against us.
Yes.
We don't have to worry about it. We just got to trust you.
Yes.
We thank you, Lord, for hearing us.
Yes.
And oh God, we thank you for answering us.
Yes.
Now, God, as we prepare to go our separate ways, we pray, oh God, that you go with us and before. We pray that you will bring us back at the appointed time. And may you forgive us for every sin that we ever committed. Bless our church. Bless us, I pray, in Jesus' name. And let all God's people say,
amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Please be seated for a moment. Silence and meditation.